So hello and welcome to PopCon and COMICAVE's first digital event of 2021. This is now the panel of geeks, and we're joined by Arafat and of course our esteemed guest, Fabian Nicieza. So Fabian, would you like to greet your fans first?
I'd like to say hello to everybody, all the geeks who are asking questions, all the geeks who send in questions. My advice to you, please, is get a life. Thank you very much, everybody.
I think that's the best.
We got Arafat wearing a Wolverine t-shirt to a Deadpool anniversary party. At least Ian is properly geeked out. I mean, look at him.
I mean, come on. Fabian, you're the creator of Deadpool. You have to admit that even Deadpool would be happy to not see his face on a t-shirt and see Wolverine celebrating him, because you know how good friends they are and how well they get along.
How close they are, They're just in the border.
They're like this. They're just buddies.
Exactly. Cool.
All right.
Man.
Maybe Arafat can start off with the first questions, the first guys who had their questions sent in.
Yeah, that's awesome. Look, there are a ton of people that have sent in videos, have sent in questions on social media. So, Fabian, I'm sorry to say, but you seem to be really popular.
I am. It's a curse. It's been a curse. My beauty is a curse and a burden.
Oh, wow. See, that's Deadpool talking, man.
Exactly. And I know you've been working on a lot of cool new stuff, from novels to new comics, and we'll sort of talk about that later. But we are celebrating Deadpool. Right now. So
30
as
years,
you might
man.
Be able to see from the background, and not from my Star Wars background and stuff, but Ian's proper background. And let's get this show on the road. So the first question we have is from one of our local heroes. He is the owner of our one and only local comic book store here that gets new titles every week. I spend way too much money with him, Saeed Arjumand.
Yeah.
Saeed's question is to you, Fabian, and I'm sure you've got this before. But Deadpool out in New Mutants, as you know, another character, as many have done over the course of the title, and it turned out that he became one of the most popular characters, leading characters in not only his own movie but comic books and crossovers and so much more. Do you ever look back and think, how the heck did this happen? How did he become so huge?
No, honestly, no, because it didn't happen in a vacuum. I didn't wake up one morning in 2016 and all of a sudden Deadpool was popular. I watched it happening year by year by year, especially with the growth of social media. So from the week the New Mutants 98 came out, we knew that the character had resonated with a lot of fans very quickly, even through such a short appearance, because the response we got to that issue, the majority of it was wow, this is so exciting. Rob's stuff is so cool. So much is going on. But within the context of that response from the readers, a significant portion of it was saying that Deadpool was funny, bring him back. Because he could have easily been a throwaway 7-page character appearance, you know? Right. So immediately we knew that something about him had clicked. And he should have had a miniseries within a year, but because of everything that was going on with Rob's schedule and with Image, and then everything that it took Joe Madureira so much time to draw the first miniseries, the first miniseries came out later than Marvel normally would have wanted something to come out with that character on the logo, you know? So the character had so many ebbs and flows in his publishing history that it was never the kind of thing where you think, he's going to be bigger than Mickey Mouse, because nobody thinks that way when you're doing this stuff. They're monthly comics. You got to start worrying about the next one and the one after that and the one after that. You don't have the time or the luxury. Stan Lee never thought Spider-Man would be around 50, 60 years later. You know what I mean? When he was writing Spider-Man in the early 60s. I did know from 2008, 2010, when I was working on Cable and Deadpool, I knew that something was percolating with the character because social media was starting to lift him up. Cosplayer videos from conventions on YouTube were getting more views than we had people reading the comic book. So that meant more people were knowing who he was. The video game expanded him to a whole new audience. The movie took him into a stratosphere, but in the 5 years before that movie came out, it had already been happening through licensing and through and merchandise that was being sold in stores to a teenage marketplace. So it, like I said, it wasn't lightning hitting me going, wow, he's popular. I watched it all happening little by little. So it wasn't a shock because he's an interesting twist on an expected character type. You know, he's not what you expect out of a mercenary action adventure hero or villain, you know, and that made it interesting.
Cool. I mean, another guy sent his question, Nader. So simply put, he's asking, is there anything you would have considered changing in him? Like, you know, anything, any color scheme, any character?
No, I think Rob's design was great. I loved Rob's design from the very beginning. And the fact it still holds up to this day. It's a really good character design. Like I had talked during a previous session, I probably would have really made him more like Snake Eyes. I think if Deadpool hadn't talked, he'd be more popular today. That's what I should have done.
Okay. So
okay, well, I was saying
what you mentioned about the pouches.
You'd want more pouches, right? You need more pouches. You can't ever have enough pouches.
You know, one time when I was writing Cable Deadpool, I actually laid out the pouches on a little drawing and tried to list everything that was going to be in them. And I gave up because I thought it was silly to lock it in. That's when you do something like that, then fans automatically go berserk if he's reaching for the pouch that's supposed to have bullets in it. He ends up getting paprika instead. And so I decided to forget about it. But at one point I had all these little things that he was going to have in all the little pouches. And some of them, as you can imagine, were a little unnecessary.
You could have just had him shooting himself in the foot. No. All right. Let's move on.
Well, then I would have needed a new foot in one of the pouches. There you go.
All right. So, next question. Yeah, it's from Waleed.
What is your favorite Deadpool story, whether in the comics or in the movies?
I, as far as the movies go, they've only made two. They need to make a lot more. So that way I can get a check every time they make a movie. I thought the first movie was excellent. I thought it was an absolutely excellent adaptation of pre-existing story material told with a lot of original content as well. I think Paul and Rhett, the writers, did a great job in constructing that. It's just an excellent two-hour movie. And they got a lot of mileage out of it based on their budget, that's for sure. As far as the comics are concerned, I've read very, very little Deadpool comics since 2008, and that's when I stopped writing Cable and Deadpool. So I really can't speak to what gets done in the comics. For me, reading the comic, the Deadpool comic, is an absolutely no-win situation. If I like it, then I'm jealous that they did a good job with it. And if I don't like it, then I'm angry that they did a bad job with it. So why bother reading it at all? To that extent, though, I think Joe Kelly's first 2 years was just really, really good, smart comic book writing. As far as I'm concerned, for me, my favorite Deadpool stories in Cable and Deadpool generally revolved around Cable more than Deadpool, and my fun with Deadpool is having him play off of such big world-changing important events that Cable gets involved in. So for me, the initial storyline where Cable's powers escalated in the first year and all the, you know, S.H.I.E.L.D. and Silver Surfer trying to take him down. Meanwhile, Deadpool's trying to join the X-Men and he wears Marvel Girl's 1960s costume, the miniskirt costume. That's, for me, the joy of Deadpool, getting him involved in what should normally be very serious things, but he handles them in his own special way.
Fantastic. Arf, I think Trina has a question as well, right?
Trina does have a question. Our DJ, Trina, has a really interesting question, actually. She asked, was the whole breaking the fourth wall originally planned from the very first issue with Deadpool, or is that something that just happened, one of the issues, and you decided, oh, this works, let's stick with it?
Well, it happened, it evolved over the course of time. And some people, I think, say Joe Kelly's the first one who did it. I think Joe Kelly says Christopher Priest is the first one who did it. I did it to a really minor extent in the first Deadpool miniseries at the very end, where he's almost looking back at the camera, but I couldn't go as far as having him acknowledge the audience because the editor wouldn't have accepted that at that time. The truth of the matter is that Deadpool is Bugs Bunny meets the Frankenstein's monster, okay? And Bugs Bunny always broke the fourth wall and looked back at the audience to let them know that he's in on the joke. Bugs Bunny's famous line from his cartoons was looking at the audience and going, "Ain't I a stinker?" And so that the audience can go, "Yeah, you are a stinker. go ahead, go make Elmer Fudd look like an idiot. Go for it." That's the tacit understanding between character and audience that you're an endearing ass. You know, you're acknowledging that you're a jerk, but it's you and the audience get that it's okay with each other. So I know that if I'd kept writing Deadpool, I would have gotten to it eventually once I had an editor that would have allowed me to do that. And I think that all of us have gotten to the point where we've done it too much. I certainly did it too much in Cable and Deadpool, both because I had the freedom to do it, but also because I chose to have Deadpool narrate the opening page, which was our story so far, and the letter column at the end with Deadpool answering the letters. The minute you do that, you're bookending your entire issue, you're bookending with a communication between the character and the reader, a direct communication between them. And that changes the dynamics and the parameters of the relationship between the audience and the content, you know? So I think in hindsight, I think it works excellently if used in moderation. And using it in moderation is a challenge because from a creative standpoint, it's a really fun thing to do. So if you don't do it, you're actually denying yourself an opportunity to have fun in the story with the character and with the audience. So it becomes an actual real challenge and a bit of a tug of war between the writer and the content. And then in turn, the content and the audience. So it's an interesting aspect of the whole character and the whole character's evolution. It was not an initial thing that I thought I could do because the editor I was working with struggled tremendously with humor. just as a concept, he struggled tremendously with humor. So I'm confident that I would have done it eventually, but I never got the chance. So seeing other people had done it basically gave me the creative freedom to be able to do it too. It gives the Ryan Reynolds the creative freedom to do it in the movies, and it becomes an expectation between everybody involved.
Fantastic.
Love it. That's wonderful. Yeah, really wonderful.
We've had some guys actually send their questions, but the majority of them is bordering on the movies.
If the question is, do you like getting a check when they make a movie? My answer is yes. if the questions have anything to do with how they're developed, how they're made, how they're written, what's coming up, I have zero involvement in it whatsoever. So my answer would be, I'll know whether I like it or not when my ass is sitting in a movie theater. And hopefully it will be one day again.
Yes, exactly.
Actually, some of the questions are just asking your opinion, which would be interesting. You touched on this a little bit earlier, Fabian, but one of our resident superstar radio jockeys over here, Brent Black,
Yes.
He's a huge, huge fan. Deadpool I think fan. You may have actually met him when you came to Comic-Con here many years ago, but he had a question. I think maybe he's been thinking of this. So, you know, he's asking you, like, would you want to see a more sort of degenerate version of the character in the films, or would you want to see a different version of Deadpool in the films, or do you think they've got it spot on?
I think for the most part, they really got it spot on in the movies. They successfully made an R-rated movie that can be considered family friendly if your family is a group of psychotic killers. I don't think that changing that formula would be a smart thing for them to do as far as their movie brand goes. That being said, the character existed as a PG-13 character for 25 years before a movie even came out as an R-rated movie. So the character could easily exist as a PG-13 property. You know, I don't think that it would change some of the humor, but it wouldn't change the kind of humor they do or the tone of the humor. Other than the struggle between R-rated or PG-13 rated, I don't think that there's anything that they've done in the existing movies that couldn't accommodate themselves to a Marvel Studios Disney approach. And I think Marvel's already said that if they make another Deadpool movie, they're going to make it R-rated. So we'll see it. You know, and as a result, I also think it's very problematic for them to fold the character into the mainstream Marvel cinematic universe that we're used to, because those have all been of a tone, of a level, and I don't think that it would make a lot of sense to fold the two together. I hope that they find a way to keep Deadpool movies in a little pocket corner, just like the characters always existed. But when I used to get to write them, he always existed in a corner nobody paid attention to at Marvel. As he got more popular, then all of a sudden he becomes an Avenger, which I think is ridiculous. But okay, I hope that they keep the movies in a little pocket corner. Maybe if they're doing all this Doctor Strange and the multiverse stuff, maybe we'll find out that the Deadpool movies are actually taking place in a separate part of the multiverse. And that's fine with me too, because I don't think he should be interacting with Tom Holland's Spider-Man. No. I think that would be incredibly uncomfortable to do that.
All right. I mean, right now, there's two more guys who actually had a question that's related to it, Kevin and Omar. So their question is, what series in the current storylines would you like to see in the film? And, you know, like, even if it's your own personal work or something.
No, I don't. I honestly never have given it 5 seconds worth of thought. Besides the fact that I don't read the comics, I can't tell you what the current storylines have been for the last 10 years. Uh-huh. So I don't even know how well they would translate to film. I think that a movie is a 2-hour structure, and movie writing structures are very specific. They have done a very good job of figuring out how to cherry pick things from the comics continuity and plug them into a 2-hour structure. So My honest answer is let the people who are getting paid to do the work, and I'm not gonna worry about it until my butt is sitting in the theater watching the movie. That's the honest truth. I don't give it 2 seconds worth of thought.
Fair enough. I have another guy who's on the line, who's waiting to be accepted. This is William. Let me just bring him in.
This is going to be fun.
Yes, it's going to be animated. So,
is a surprise question coming in?
No. Brace yourself. Brace yourself, Fabian.
William is on the line. Let's see. There you go. Oh, there you go. There's William. Mr. William.
What's going William. On?
How hey, are
guys.
You?
What's up, Ian? Man, I'm good, man. What's going on, Ian? Arafat.
How you doing?
What's up, man? long time to
forget about. Oh man. Forget about us. Fabian's online.
Oh, Fabian's here with us, man.
I just what are you? The screen. I don't. Yep. I want to know, is William laying down in bed to talk to us? He hasn't even gotten up and had coffee and nothing. He's just laying down in bed. What are you doing, man?
Fabian, shut up, man. I'm here in the UAE, but I'm from Brooklyn, right? I'm from Brooklyn. And Fabian, I'm telling you, man, I think I want to take you to family court. You owe me back child support. You raised me.
I did. How do I owe you back child support if I raised you? If I raised you, clearly I've been an important part of your life on a daily basis. So I don't owe you any back child support.
I think
I was there for you, William.
You traumatized him. That's probably what it means.
I've been there for you every day, William.
Every day. I'm going to tell you. Look, I was 1977. I was born. I've been reading comics since 82. And like I said, I started off with the X-Force and Alpha Flight.
I'm sorry to hear that, William.
What are you talking
about? There's many better comics you could have started off with.
Yo, that's where I started. And then, when Deadpool ran his own exclusive comic, because it was funny, because if you were at the shops in Brooklyn, all the guys was like, you know, for the guys who haven't read New Mutants, they were like, is that Spider-Man? They was like,
there you go.
Yeah. They was like, when did Spider-Man start carrying katanas? You know?
And so, everybody, you know, always says he's a parody of Deathstroke, which he isn't and never was. The truth of the matter is he's really Spider-Man meets Punisher, just like Rob said.
Fact.
There you go. You have now the answer. Right?
There it is. There's proof. Proof is in the pudding.
Yeah.
Perpetually 15-year-old William has just responded.
Thanks. Thanks so much, William, for joining
us, William.
Man. Yo, thank you, man. Awesome. Hey, shout out, Fabian. Much love, man. Arafat, Ian.
Take care,
thank
William.
You, God.
Thank you. Thank you.
You're good, man.
Oh, my goodness. You had me in tears there, Fabian. I almost collapsed. Oh, goodness. All right.
I don't understand why he's trying to milk me for money when clearly I've been there every step of the way for this young man's growth.
All right.
And obviously I fed him well too. So there.
So there is one more who wanted to speak with you. Her name is Razan, she's here.
She's a local filmmaker and massive fan.
Here you go. There.
Guys, are we on?
Yep, there she is.
Are you guys there?
Yeah.
I was freezing.
Razan, are you with us?
I only see your ugly face.
Oh, there you go.
There she is, thank you.
Hello, hey guys.
Hi.
Hi, how's it going?
Thank you for joining us, by the way.
No problem. Thank you for having me.
Always. So now you have the chance to talk to Fabian. You have any questions for him?
Yes. Hi, Fabian. Thank you so much for speaking to me. I'm clearly a fan.
Another nerd heard from.
Absolutely. 100%. So my question is, now that inevitably Deadpool is going to show up in a Marvel film owned by Disney, what do you think his first, maybe hopefully, what do you think his first Disney joke would be?
I don't know. I can't. Number one, I try not to write on demand. Number two, I've tried very hard in a professional writing career to never write unless I'm getting paid to write. So, as a result, I hate to tell you this, but your answer is, unless I'm being paid to write the first Disney joke by Disney, then the answer is, the people getting paid will be the ones who make that joke. So
I think that's Deadpool's answer. And exactly. Deadpool wouldn't do it for free either.
The screenwriters who have been hired to write the next movie are hard at work right now answering your question. All right.
Cool. Well, Razan, thank you again. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Razan. So much.
All right. So moving forward, Arafat himself is a big comic reader, collector, and whatsoever. He has a question for you about your work, X-Men Legends. So Arafat.
Yeah, well, as you know, I am a big fan of comics, not of you, Fabian, but just generally comics.
No, it's
comics.
Understandable.
But yeah. but you know what I've been really excited about is your upcoming work. You, as I said, you've got a novel coming out as well, but you're also writing this, which I think I'm so excited about, X-Men Legends, which is like a throwback to the 90s X-Men. And I wanted to hear from you. Is Deadpool going to be in there? And what are the plans? Any hints you can give? I know it's about the the third Summers brother, but.
What I will say is that it seems Marvel hasn't done a great job messaging what this book was going to be, because I've received a lot of questions that indicate a sense of confusion about the book. Okay. X-Men Legends is an anthology series, which means it will have different stories by different creative teams of different lengths. Okay. Uh-huh. They contacted me months ago and asked if I would be interested in doing a two-part story and a self-contained one-issue story that could take place during the time period in which I wrote the book. And if I had any stories that I didn't get to tell back then that I'd be interested in telling. And the truth of the matter was, I didn't have that many, because my entire tenure on the X books was stories I didn't get a chance to tell, but not the kinds of stories you normally could have told in a two-part or one-part aspect, right? So I asked them if I could do the Adam X story, and they said yes. And they said it's also in continuity. I don't know how that will work within the context of everything that's happened in the last 30 years in the comics, but they said it's going to be in continuity. And I said, fine, because my original Adam X story was always a 4-issue miniseries plan. That's 88 pages of story back then. Mm-hmm. And I was going to be getting 40 pages of story now. So I was going to have to figure out how to tell that story in a condensed fashion. It was almost a lucky circumstance that while we were working on it, they actually decided to make it the launch of the series. Mm-hmm. And I was going to get 10 more pages in the first issue. So issue one is a 30-page issue. Issue two is a regular 20-page issue. So I get 50 pages out of what my original plans were for 88. So it was a matter of just making that original story work. It doesn't need to work for today's continuity because it's taking place then. All right. This issue, first two issues take place immediately after Captain Marvel number 3, which was the last time I wrote Adam X and Eric the Red. And it follows a few months after the events of that story. And yes, I'm telling the story that I originally wanted to tell. I'm telling it in almost exactly the same way that I had wanted to do it. I had to cut out a lot of in between stuff and a lot of character interaction stuff just to keep it kind of to the bones. Not a lot of meat on it, as it were, but the beginning, the middle, and the end is exactly what I originally had planned. The way I leave Adam X off is exactly how I had planned, because even back then, I understood the complications that this character brought to the continuity. But he was developed within the context of the editor wanting to see those complications at first. So after me, and after me and Brett Booth do our story, I think Louise and Walt Simonson are doing an X-Factor story. I don't know if it's one part or two parts or what. I'm pretty sure that Chris Claremont and Larry Hama and Peter David are working on stories as well. So I don't know the orders in which these will come out. But everybody who's involved in the book, for the most part, I think are going to be creators who were involved in the books during the totality of its history, not just the 1990s. If Walt and Louise are doing a story, it's really probably going to be when they were doing X-Factor, you know? Mm-hmm. And if Chris is doing a story, clearly it could be any time within the 17 years that he wrote the book, right? So that's what X-Men Legends is. So awesome. I'm only in the first two issues, and I wrote one more that we haven't even gotten drawn yet. So there's a one more self-contained issue. It could appear at any time. I don't know. It could be issue 8. It could be issue 28. I don't know. Okay. So that's what it is. So my story is pretty self-contained. It's the first two issues, and it's the truth about Adam X is revealed.
I see.
Well, I'm actually more excited right now because I didn't know that at all. That's really cool. So thank you.
Yeah, at least wait, now till, we know. Look,
you want to talk about the man boys being excited for this comic, because they are. If you were 10 or 15 or 20 back in the early 90s, I understand why you would get enthusiastic and excited about the possibilities of a book like this. I will tell you that you will remember what it was like to be 12 years old and buying your comic books when you see Brett Booth's artwork in these first two issues.
Amazing.
It will do for you what seeing excellent George Perez or Jim Starlin or early John Byrne artwork does for me, because I was 14, 15, 16 years old when those guys were doing their work in the mid 70s. You know what I mean? It's that same kind of an emotional reaction that you're going to get when you see Brett's artwork, because it is just ridiculously good in this book. And I purposefully planned some big shot moments that would really give him a chance to draw some crazy stuff. I purposely set an extensive chunk of the first issue set in a cornfield in Iowa, because I knew Brett would draw every single kernel of corn on every stalk of
that
corn.
That was intentional.
I did it intentionally. I really did do it intentionally, because I wanted to see if Brett would be crazy enough to draw every stalk of corn. And he was. It's the kind of thing that is going, the hope is that without copying the style of a time, it will still elicit the emotions you felt at that time. And I do think the story will do that, because it's got the big kind of pow moments that make you feel like you're 14, 15 year old reading a comic.
Right.
Brilliant.
All right. And I think that's all for the panel of the geeks. Thank you for completing the questions. The next.
Thank you, geeks.
The next segment.
You're welcome.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, that's not good. No, no, no. Oh, you're not going to walk that one off. Oh, that's so gross.